thank you, Pietro, for the nice presentation, and thank you also to Yoli for organizing this very interesting special session. So, as Pietro said, I'm a physicist. I'm working in Trieste at the International School for Advanced Studies, CISA, and I work on the modeling of chromosome folding by using polymer physics. So, since the schedule is quite tight, I go directly to the outline of my talk. So, I first will present the problem and why it's interesting, and also our understanding about it. And then I will show, if I have time, a couple of more recent applications, and then I will tell you about how, I mean, a bit about the physics of these models. So I have to stress the fact, sorry, I forgot, that this work has, most of it has been done in collaboration with Raph Evers from the École Normale Supérieure in Lyon, France. So let's go to the problem. So first of all, why the problem is interesting, why is it timely to study it? The fact now, that we have a lot of experiments to about the biology of the chromosomes. These are just three examples that are quite well known from probably for most of you. One is a fish from by which you can mark specific sequences or entire chromosome inside the cells, and you can see them. The other technique is 3C chromosome conformation capture, and these filiations like HiC. By which you can measure contact frequencies between chromosomes, and then this technique needs cells to be fixed, while chromatin tagging by GFP you can measure the diffusion and mobility properties of chromatin in vivo. So these three techniques are quite nice, because then you can get very quantitative results about the morphology and the dynamic of chromosomes inside the cells. The striking, so the problem of how chromosome fold is actually is very fascinating for a physicist for the following reason. Just I take the example of the human nucleus. So we have 46 chromosomes. Each chromosome is long 1 centimeter, has a diameter of around 10 nanometer, and all these chromosomes have to share a nuclear volume of 1,000 micrometer cubed. So if you do your work, I mean, do the proportion, this is like to storing 46 ropes of 1 kilometer, more or less long, of very thin, of course, and just 1 millimeter thin, in a bag of 1 meter cube. Of course, I mean, they will fit perfectly in the bag, but the problem is that how you can fit all these ropes without creating, a tangled mass. So this is, how you can store it in an efficient way. So this is the real question to the problem. And the way we did it, we just observed the biology. So, as you know, the chromosomes undergo the cell cycle, right? And they are very compact during mitosis and separated from each other. And then at the beginning of the next phase, which is interphase, they are contained inside the nucleus and they start to swell. And by fluorescence in situ hybridization, people have demonstrated that swelling of chromosome is not, does not occupy all the possible space available to in the nucleus. But each chromosome occupies a definite region inside the nucleus, which is called the chromosome territory. So this is an example of a chicken fibroblast, and each territory was shown by fish. So each color identifies one chromosome. And this is this is a feature that basically holds for most of organisms, mammalian, so apes, mice, including humans and plants also. So this is a very general feature. So the way we understood the problem with Raph was the following. So what we did, we tried to to simulate, right, the swelling of chromosomes at the end of the mitosis. So we started to keep the system as simple as possible from four model human chromosomes. So each this is one very long polymer chain. We put it inside a box, and we simulated the system by molecular dynamics. And we used the construction, just to give you an idea, is a long chain. Is each sphere here, if you can see it, is just one single monomer of your polymer chain, and this is folded in a sort of helix. So you start from here and then you go here. So this is the cross section of the helix, and this is the axis of the helix. So this is just to mimic the initial configuration at the mitosis, and then you let these things to swell you study it by molecular dynamics. This is a very simple for those of you who don't know, it's a very simple numerical technique, and we just used standard feature of polymer physics, namely chromatin or polymer stiffness, density, and hardcore repulsion between monomers. That's it. These are very standard ingredients. And if you do this kind of simulation, this was already quite big. It involves 100,000 particles, so it's already quite demanding a simulation. You get the following. So at the end of the simulation, you get something which resembles territory, in the sense that each chromosome can be identified by its own region inside the simulation box. And so this is at the larger level. Then you can go into more details, and you can ask what is the typical, if I pick up 2 points on my chromatin fiber, what is the typical distance, the typical average distance between them. Okay, this is a quantity that you can measure, for instance, by fish. So you can compare the results of our simulation directly to the experiments. Here the symbol represents the experiments, while the lines represent the result of the simulation. And you can the different colors are for different organisms studying the literature, and you can see that we don't do too bad, in the sense that we are able to reproduce the experiments very satisfactorily. This is for fish. Beyond that, we also compare our result of our simulation. These are exactly the same simulation, but with different data, namely with this high C data for chromosome frequencies. And here again, symbols and stands for experiments and lines for simulations. And you can see that also we were able to reproduce the results from the experiment. So then we used this model more recently in order to, so once we, let's say we have set up the model, we used it in two different applications. One was done in collaboration with Marco Di Stefano, who is here, I think. I see, yeah, he's there. And who was a PhD student in CIS, and in collaboration with Cristian Micheletti. And what we did, we studied a proof of concept of what is known as the co-localization, co-regulation hypothesis, namely. It is known that there are some genes which are co-localized in space once they are found to be co-transcribed. And so we mapped the presence, the position of these genes along our model chromatin fiber for a typical case study, the human chromosome 19. We chose this human chromosome 19 because it was very gene rich, so it represented a very nice case study. And we forced pairs of genes which are co-transcribed to be co-localized in space. We did what is called the Stern molecular dynamics, and we found indeed that this is quite feasible. So we found a lot of genes which are co-transcribed, which can be also co-localized in space. So this was a very powerful, I think, demonstration that these things can also. These are not proof that every cross-transcribed gene pair can be co-localized, but proves that it's feasible, at least, I mean, from a polymer point of view. And the second application we did, this was in collaboration with a master student who came from Lyon to visit me last year, Manon Vallée. We applied this model to the study of called the viscoelasticity of interface chromosomes. This is also a very interesting property. The idea beyond that is that you insert micro probes inside any possible polymer solution, in this case inside the nucleus, in order to study the diffusion properties of molecules of the size more or less, any desirable size in principle. But of course, we tried with sizes of typical of around the nanometers, and in this way you probe directly the diffusion properties of the nucleus. And this is interesting, of course, once you want to know, for instance, how proteins diffuse in the very crowded medium. What we get, so this is in fact is a very quantitative technique, in the sense that you can do some algebra, and what you get from the diffusion from the diffusive motion of the microprobes is two important quantities, which are the elastic modulus and the viscous modulus. Namely, you can measure how elastic and how viscous the nuclear medium is. And so we measured something like the diffusion coefficient of these particles and the viscosity of the medium as a function of the size of the particle, and we obtain a remarkably good agreement with the experiments. In particular, we saw that the viscosity of the nucleus turns out to be much larger compared, for instance, much larger, I mean, larger than what is for just standard water. One thing which was very nice, we could measure the so-called elastics and viscous modulus, and we found that so nucleus is slightly more viscous than elastic, in sense that it behaves more like a liquid than like a solid. This in principle is not surprising from a polymer point of view, but it's interesting in the sense that what they found in experiments is, let's say, to be honest, is the opposite. And actually this was quite interesting, so this suggests how also the model could be improved in order to take into account more realistic representation of the nucleus itself. So this was a very first tentative in order to see what happens in the nucleus. So now that I have explained to you how much time do you have? 10 minutes. Okay, so I think it's good because this requires a bit more explanation. So once we set up, I mean, once we have these results, so one can ask, okay, why this model seems to work well. And so now I'll go a bit inside, into the real physics of the problems of the chromosome folding. And what is actually very interesting from it is that the problem of chromosome folding is a very nice so-called topological problems in polymer physics. And what I mean by topology is the following. So if you ask, do chromosomes behave like equilibrated linear polymers? So by equilibrated linear polymers, I mean what you have in ordinary polymer solution. So in ordinary polymer solution, copolymer, or you can think to chromosome if you want, are not actually expected to be territorially confined, as you see in experiments, but should swell and should, let's say, look like an entangled spaghetti dish, if you want, okay? So this is this is very known in polymer physics, you can ask why we don't observe it. We don't observe this kind of feature it can be for many different reasons, but this is a very pertinent question, I think. So you can ask, the next question that you can ask is that how does long it take for chromosomes to become equilibrated linear polymers? So there is a nice theoretical prediction, which is due to Pierre-Gilles Degenne and Dwight Edwards, that the time required the chromosomes to mix would be proportional to the cube of their length. So if you put numbers here, then you got with these predictions. So this is for different organisms, yeast, fruit fly, and Homo sapiens, which have different, very different chromosome size. I mean, 1 megabase, 10 megabase, and 100 megabase, roughly. And you get that the so-called mixing oil equilibration time is very different. So you get 1 hour, roughly, for Saccharomyces cerevisiae, and because of this cube, these times just explode for fruit fly and humans. So that means that actually, if you start from a configuration which is not equilibrated at the beginning, you could never observe equilibration at all because you don't have the time to observe it. So basically, chromosome gets stuck in some off-equilibrium configuration. And actually, what is important is the beginning of the interface. At the beginning of the interface, chromosomes are separated. This is no, because they come from the previous mitosis, so they are not linked or concatenated. And this is an assumption that was made a bit later. They are not knotted, so they don't form knots, I mean, like the strings of the shoes. This is, I think, is a less important assumption, but it is also an important assumption. It was made late in the beginning of the 80s by Alexander Grossberg. So if you start, if you made this observation that the initial topological state is important, then you can say, okay, each chromosome is a very long polymer chain, right? I start from something which is, from configuration which are separated in space. The only the only features that would allow chromosomes to interpenetrate each other to become equilibrated is the interpenetration of the chain ends, but this requires too much time. So then I can get rid of the chain ends, and I can imagine that just as a sort of Gedanken experiment, that my chromosome, the core of my chromosome, behaves like equilibrated solution now semi-dilute solution of unentangled ring polymers. So of course, we know that chromosomes are not ring polymers, but the core of this structure would behave like those. And in fact, if you do precisely the same simulation as before, so with a model but just with ring polymers, not with linear chains, you get that the bulk of ring polymers at equilibrium perfectly reproduce the bulk of linear chains at equilibrium, but which are not equilibrated. Now, this feature is quite interesting for two following reasons. First, because the physics of ring polymers is much less known than physics of linear polymers, so this is much more interesting. And second, because you can now use the physics, you can build, this is what we did in last year with RAF, you can build a multi-scale polymer physics model, which is based on coupling, on using two different techniques, Monte Carlo and molecular dynamics, in order to build a so-called a multi-scale approach to the description of chromosome, which is very efficient, because now you can construct, with a very small computational time, you can simulate basically the entire human nucleus. So this is a simulation, you can see, it's very big, it's around 2 million monomer particles, chain here represents an individual human chromosome, of course, and you have 64 of different chromosomes. I just use 64 because of for computational reason, but I'm not limited to this. I can do 46. This was just to prove the efficiency of the algorithm. Actually, then you can go to the to the properties of single chains, and what we see that this represents a nice feature of the chromosome, namely that things which are close in sequence are also close in space. So here the one chain was rainbow colored, so the same color indicates closing also in sequence and inside the chromosome. And so then you can compare to this model that was proposed a few years ago, the so-called fractal or crumpled globule, and you can see that the morphology, our territory is it's still fractal in the sense that it's a sort of a branched structure. But it's not a globule in strictly speaking globule, in the sense that it is not a globular shape, but it's more branched precisely, and this implies that we observe a lot of this from the simulation point of view, we observe a lot of intermingling between different chromosomes inside the model nucleus. So here in one color, the gray here represents one chromosome, while the other colors represent the penetration of the outer chromosome into the territory of the gray chromosome. And so then this is a bit of the outlook, what we would like to do. We would like to characterize more what is the topological feature that is the size of 100 kb, which would be the statistical size of one of these, which became very famous in the latest years, topologically associated domains. And also see what it happens, because this model is homogeneous in the sense that we have not inserted any sequence information, what it happens if we put the genomic information inside our fiber. And I think this is more or less all. So I just want to acknowledge computational resources, of course, because that requires, we require a lot of computational resources, an Italian grant, and also discussion by several people and friends during these last years. And of course, I want to thank you for your attention.
Hi, I'm Michal Inyal. I'm the program chair of this special session. So I want to take this opportunity to thank the organizer for the effort of putting this together. And I just want to say that on behalf of myself and ISCB, CCB, it's really a great pleasure to have you here, both the audience, but the organizers. And this is just a small token of appreciation to Pietro and Yoli, please. So. And it's an opportunity also to say that it seems very heavy load, but Once you have the good idea and you have, you know, really hot topics, just approach us, provide a suggestion, and we'll encourage you to build up for the next year another one like this. So thank you, and sorry for your time.
No problem.
We have a little time for questions, or we can do advance. Let's say one question now, and then at the end of the session we will have more, and also Angelo will be around for the rest of the day. And please.
Yeah, I was wondering about your assumption regarding the knots.
Mm-hmm.
There's enzymes for denotting DNA.
Sure.
A community which studies knotting in DNA, so how important is that?
This assumption was made back, by Alexander Grossberg, and was also a physicist. And so the assumption, I think, is not really crucial in the sense that my structure that I produced at the beginning are also minimally noted. I saw some of them which are noted, but they are, it's not very important on the global level, so they are, represents noise. Knots maybe would be important in the sense that if they are localized, they would from a polymer perspective, they would create some mechanical stress on the structure, and maybe they eventually could break DNA. But of course, I agree with you. I mean, there are these kind of enzymes which are able to relax the local topology. They are probably not crucial to this so big description of the chromosome, I think.
We will have